Again, I would like to extend my appreciation to the Bellview congregation, the elders, good brother Michael Hatcher, for the opportunity to be here. And I would like to mention, for those who might be watching this online via the internet, I would certainly like to encourage you to be present for these, because there's a lot that goes on to enjoy with one another that's beyond what we have in the lectures themselves. Certainly, I've enjoyed tremendously the fellowship, the time we've had to intermingle, to commiserate, to reminisce, to talk maybe about some doctrinal matters, maybe even to butt heads a little bit. Love you, Brother Hightower. But we certainly enjoyed the time we've had with each other. And of course, the lectures have been nothing short of fantastic. I would also like to encourage you to get the book, because you will find as you go through the manuscripts that there's a lot of material that brethren simply aren't able to deal with in the time they have to speak. And so get the book as well and get all you can from this lectureship. Again, I appreciate the good lecture we had just a moment ago from Brother Tim Kozad. He spoke about being impressed with me. I would believe I was far more impressed with him. What a fantastic sermon he had during the past hour, and well delivered. And certainly he impressed me from the beginning, however. He told me he was learning patience, but I don't think there's anything that impressed me quite so much with him as his patience. As we kind of had a little exchange of roommates, and I was just amazed at how well he did with that. Much better than I had. So I certainly appreciate him in that. And I appreciate the good patience of brethren such as Michael Hatcher and the long-suffering in dealing with brethren who might get their manuscripts in just a little bit past the deadline. Just a little. We certainly appreciate the necessary subject of study, the theme of innovations. We rightly praise innovation when it comes to many fields. When it comes to technology, we praise it. When it comes to medicine and new developments in medicine, we praise innovation. In sports, we praise and herald the development of such things as the forward pass, such things as the T formation. We praise innovation in music and business and all sorts of things. As Steve Jobs, the late co-founder of Apple and CEO of Apple, said, innovation distinguishes between a leader and a follower. And so this is true in so many realms, but when it comes to the things of God, there is no place for innovation. Brother David Watson, in his lecture, spoke about Jeroboam. And you look at Jeroboam and what's discussed in 1 Kings 12, 28 through 33, and you count the times that it said he made. He made, or he created something. You might say he innovated. It talks about something that he devised in his heart, but yet the thing became sin. Jeroboam, you might call the archetypal innovator. But you see, his innovation is not to be praised. And all those other realms we mentioned, we praise innovation because there is improvement to be made. We talk about building a better mousetrap. That implies that there are improvements to be made upon it. There are faster planes you can make. There are faster and smaller computers we can make. Can you imagine watching football today without the forward pass? There were improvements to make. But when it comes to the things of God, there is no improvement to be made. In Deuteronomy 32 and verse 4, we're told, he is a rock. His works are perfect. For all his ways are judgment, a God of truth and without iniquity, just and right is he. But we're told his works are perfect. What improvements then can be made upon that? And what improvements can be made with regard to the social gospel, the topic under consideration this evening? Now, as we want to talk about this, we obviously need to begin by defining what is the social gospel. And I was introduced, as this was my topic assigned to me, into a heavy study of something that I admittedly had a limited understanding about. The term and concept has been variously defined. You'll hear the term being thrown about and used in different ways. But let me give you some definitions. In the New Oxford American Dictionary, the third edition, social gospel is defined as Christian faith practiced as a call not just to personal conversion, but to social reform. That's at least pointing in the right direction. But I believe Bobby Duncan gives a much more complete definition of social gospel. He defines it as the philosophy of those professed Christians whose conception of Christianity is that the major significance of the gospel is related to the needs of this present world, and that gospel, quote, preaching should be designed to correct the ills of this present life with only a passing reference to life beyond the grave, if there be any such life. In the social gospel, we see a major shift of the gospel's emphasis. The social gospel shifts the emphasis away from individual sin and accountability to societal ills. The social gospel shifts the emphasis away from serving the eternal Creator to serving the universal brotherhood of man, as you'll hear it described. The social gospel shifts the emphasis away from a heavenly hope to an earthbound mission. The social gospel, as well, shifts the church, indeed spiritually, away from its mission. It shifts the truth away and the emphasis away from spiritual truths to material needs more pressing to the carnal mind. You'll hear a key concept and term being used with the social gospel, ministering to the whole man. And it reflects that we are now going to emphasize physical things and de-emphasize the spiritual needs of man. Scripture is de-emphasized in preaching, as are key doctrines of Scripture, including the virgin birth of Christ, as well the atoning blood of Christ, as well as the resurrection of Christ. And as the social gospel makes a shift in the preaching, so it shifts the gospel's emphasis in its practice. The social gospel de-emphasizes preaching and the worship of God in favor of community benevolence and political involvement. You'll find that some of the social gospel's political causes that they'll be often involved in include advocating for labor unions, opposing war, oftentimes war in general, just protesting the idea of war. The social gospel is favor the virtual abandonment of foreign evangelism altogether in favor of medical missions. Instead of focusing on preaching the gospel to redeem the souls of men, the social gospel focuses on feeding the hungry, righting social injustices, and meeting any number of physical needs, or sometimes what might be called felt needs. Sometimes the social gospel represents a call to social reform with the complete absence altogether of a call to personal conversion. That is a spiritual change. Now, as we have said, this is what the social gospel is. We might clarify that calling a false doctrine or system of doctrine a gospel of any kind is really a misnomer, as there is only one true gospel. The Apostle Paul said, "I marvel," Galatians 1 and verse 6, "I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. This other so-called gospel really is not a gospel at all." And so this term tells us something in and of itself. It tells us that it is something other than the one true gospel. But let's consider then the development of the social gospel. The social gospel arose not from honest souls searching the Scriptures, but from the social, scientific, theological, and political climate of the late 19th and early 20th centuries. Charles Darwin, of course, had shaken the faith of many in a divine creator. Mankind had been depreciated from his creation in God's image and his preeminent role among creation to being a beast. Yes, maybe an intelligent beast, but a beast nonetheless. Mass immigration, industrialization, other factors brought urban slums and crime, and so this is certainly a factor of that time. Advanced military technology had brought advanced numbers of deaths on the battlefield, especially bringing home to people how filthy war could be. Fresh from Germany, inspiration-denying theories of the Bible's origin had infiltrated the denominational seminaries and the university schools of divinity. Society had taken a new and much more cynical view of humanity than it had before. Society now viewed humanity far too often as that of a cheap and meaningless existence. And so we see then the social gospel arising in that climate. And there are numerous individuals that we could speak of who are instrumental in this development. But Walter Rauschenbusch is one to whom he might especially draw attention. He is sometimes called the father of the social gospel. Not that he was the one to introduce it. He was following after the pattern of such men as Washington Gladden and others who had come before him, such as Horace Bushnell. But Rauschenbusch was the one who kind of formulated many of these things. He developed a new theology regarding the social gospel, defined in the books he wrote. And in the preface to A Theology for the Social Gospel, he stated, "This is the main proposition of this book. We have a social gospel. We need a systematic theology large enough to match it and vital enough to back it." And so basically, what he is now saying is, we have decided what we're going to practice. Now we need to figure out what we're going to believe to support what we already practice. Never mind that, biblically speaking, the beliefs come first. That is, between the two. Obviously, the word precedes true belief, Romans 10:17. But with regard to belief or faith in works, the faith, the beliefs come first. If correct, then they'll produce the proper works. If you know these things, happy are ye if you do them. John 13:17. In 1 Thessalonians 1:3, Paul said, "Remembering without ceasing your work of faith and labor of love and patience of hope." That is a work that was produced by faith. In 1 Timothy 1:5, it says, "Now the end of the commandment is charity, out of a pure heart and of a good conscience and of faith unfeigned." Again, that faith produced and that charity, that loving work that needed to be produced. In James 2:18, the brother of our Lord said, "I will show thee my faith by my works." And so he already had that faith. And then it would produce the works. This tells us a little bit then about how they were thinking. Rauschenbusch went on to lament, "The pioneers of the social gospel have had a hard time trying to consolidate their old faith and their new aim." Listen to this again. "The pioneers of the social gospel have had a hard time trying to consolidate their old faith and their new aim." And so he's admitting that their aim was not directed by their faith. They chose instead to walk by sight, contrary to what Paul said we need to do. 2 Corinthians 5:7. Let's talk about then some modern manifestations of the social gospel. You see, the term social gospel is not merely a byword of past history. Unfortunately, it is alive and active today. Now, the Salvation Army may be the most obvious bearer of the social gospel torch, as evidenced by their stance. "We believe," quote, "we believe in the sacred freedom and dignity of persons and are committed to the redemption of the world in all its dimensions, physical, spiritual, social, economic, and political." See, their focus has been so predominantly on the physical, social, economic, and political that many people have no idea that the Salvation Army also deals with the spiritual, that they are, in the accommodative sense, they are a church, they are a denomination. The more theologically liberal denominations have now been living and dying by the sword of the social gospel for decades. The Episcopal Church USA has special feast days to honor Walter Rauschenbusch and other so-called heroes of the social gospel. The Disciples of Christ denomination, brought about by a split from the Churches of Christ, proudly boasts of their representation, quote, at every level of Christian social protest. They're proud of that. That's what they're involved in, Christian social protest, they say. The Disciples Justice Action Network, a wing of the Disciples of Christ denomination, boasts in their Christmas 2012 newsletter of their participation in what is called Ecumenical Advocacy Days for Global Peace with Justice. In this, they state, the theme of this year's conference will be At God's Table, Food Justice for a Healthy World. The emphasis will be on food security, ending hunger, improving nutrition, creating more just and sustainable food systems, and protecting God's creation. I mean, these are terms you don't hear being thrown about all the time. Food justice? The same issue as well revels in revealing that the Christian Church in Indiana revoked a prohibition against knowingly granting standing to gay and lesbian persons. And so now standing is allowed among gay and lesbian persons in that denomination. See, homosexual advocacy has become a common cause among social gospelers as well. But you don't just have to look to the more liberal denominations in Protestantism. Even more conservative, so-called evangelical wing of Protestantism is heavily involved in the social gospel. Evangelical superstar Rick Warren of the Saddleback Community Church and the author of the Purpose Driven series has, quote, taken the social gospel to where it's never been, as one man wrote. One example of this is found in his global PEACE, a peace plan. And this states on their website, the peace plan is a hopeful response to the five giant problems in the world. Spiritual emptiness, self-serving, leadership, poverty, disease, and illiteracy. And they go on to say then, peace is a movement to mobilize Christians and churches working together to, and then we find the alliteration of peace. P, plant churches that promote reconciliation. E, equip servant leaders. A, assist the poor. C, care for the sick. E, educate the next generation. Isn't not a little strange that among the five giant problems in the world, sin is not specifically mentioned? Not at all. No mention of it. No mention is made, as well as it speaks about their different efforts. Isn't not a little strange that no specific mention is made of saving the lost? So we see then that it is found throughout the Protestant denominational world. Of course, it's found in Roman Catholicism. But especially distressing, even the bride of Christ has been blemished by the social gospel. Most, if you ask any of these preachers here or the elders who look at the church mail regularly, they'll see that they receive email or mail on a regular basis that are promoting social gospel programs among professed churches of Christ. One that I might mention that states, the headline reads, Water Purification Church Building Launched. Water Purification Church Building Launched. Okay? It explains, in response to the request of village officials, negotiations are in progress to adopt this village of 12,000, as adopt, make them our own, like we're their parents, and attempt to raise their standard of health, education, well-being, and spirituality. We have discussed with them that great nations can only be built through education, improving the general health of its people, and teaching them the importance of ethical practices and hard work. They have asked us to help them do just that. And so they're saying, we're telling them how nations are built. You know, people have attacked our government for going out and nation building. But yet we're saying now the church is going to go out and doing nation building. This professes to be a work of the church, specifically of the Windsong Church of Christ in Little Rock, Arkansas, and it solicits funds from other churches. Yet as we look at what it does, the closest approximation of preaching the gospel in this particular work is attempting to raise a village's, quote, standard of spirituality. But when we judge by their account of their discussions with village officials, this is far from the focal point of their work. It says, we've discussed with them how great nations are built and how to say through education, improving the general health of this people, and teaching them the importance of ethical practices and hard work. Is that really what we need to be focusing ourselves upon? Other churches, churches that say they're churches of Christ, will have grocery giveaways and soup kitchens without any assessment of need. They're not making sure that these people really need these things that they're being given. I might also mention that, it's getting into a little bit on somebody else's lecture, but the gymnasiums that are being erected by more liberal congregations are, in a sense, manifestations of the social gospel. Now, certainly, Rauschenbusch would deny any affiliation with them. He wouldn't have nothing to do with the gymnasium, and many of them would probably say we would have nothing to do with the teachings of Rauschenbusch. But gymnasium churches are forced to justify their innovations by the same reason they're, quote, ministering to the whole man. That's the social gospel. Let's talk about then some problems with or errors of the social gospel. See, as I've spoken about some of these things, you might be perhaps scratching your head and saying, well, what's wrong with these things? People are hungry. Don't they need food? People don't have good water. Don't they need clean water? What's wrong with doing these types of things? Well, let's back up for a minute and look then at these problems. For one, it shifts the emphasis from the material to the spiritual. And to this, its advocates would historically agree. They really feel that the emphasis, for one, on social needs is much more compelling to the unsaved than doctrinal discourses. People who are not Christians, they hear about these benevolent works that are being done, and they may not appreciate what going out and preaching the gospel to the lost means, but they can appreciate the value of doing benevolent works. And so maybe that's more attractive to the lost. Many of them as well feel that the emphasis, that there's that shift on emphasis and emphasizing the physical is absolutely essential. Rauschenbusch brazenly asserts an outlook toward the future in which the spiritual life, and he puts that in quotes, spiritual life, is saved and the economic life is left unsaved, is both unchristian and stupid. Unchristian and stupid to see someone's soul saved without doing something to save the economic life. By such reasoning, a soul who is led to obey the gospel and remain faithful to Christ throughout his entire life, but yet remains economically poor, is a failure. Through the eye of inspiration, Solomon wrote, there is that maketh himself rich, yet hath nothing. There is that maketh himself poor, yet hath great riches. Proverbs 13 and verse 7. To the church at Smyrna, Jesus Christ said, I know thy works, and tribulation and poverty. Economic poverty. He said, but thou art rich. Revelation 2:9. Was there any promise that that would be changed? That is, their economic state would be saved as Rauschenbusch would say? No, they very well might stay economically poor, but yet they were spiritually rich. And on the other hand, the opposite hand, we have the Laodiceans in Revelation 3:17. And Jesus said, because if thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. And so, on the other hand, they were economically wealthy. But the problem, and the far greater problem, was they didn't have the needs that they really needed. You see, the social gospel focuses upon fleshly needs and places its hope in this world. This is really its hope. Rauschenbusch went so far as to say, belief in a future life is not essential to religious faith. There is doubtless an increasing number of religious men and women today who find their satisfaction in serving God now, but expect their personal existence to end at death. We think about the basis for many of the things that Rauschenbusch was teaching. And he had a perverted view of the kingdom and what the kingdom is and was, and he looked toward the kingdom as being a reconciliation of that brotherhood of man and a removing of the societal ills into a more ethical society, as he saw. That, to him, was the kingdom. Friends, we have in Jesus Christ a blood-bought institution for the spiritual salvation of mankind, Colossians 1:13. We have in Jesus Christ a kingdom that at the end will be delivered up to the Father, 1 Corinthians 15 and verse 24. Inspiration speaks of a greater vision than Rauschenbusch had, of a true hope that Rauschenbusch said wasn't necessary. In 2 Corinthians 4:18, Paul said, while we look not at the things which are seen, whether they be hunger or thirst or poverty, while we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen, for the things which are seen are temporal. They're fleeting. They'll go away. But the things which are not seen are eternal. In Colossians 3, verses 1 and 2, Paul admonished, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth at the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. Is that not Satan's great goal? To have our minds constantly upon material matters rather than on eternal matters of the Spirit. But the social gospel shifts our minds in that direction. Shifts that focus away from the spiritual to the material. Also, the social gospel shifts the church away from its mission. We are entrusted with a mission. And we speak about the work of the church. But really, our mission is to preach the gospel to every creature. Mark 16 and verse 15. Jesus said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He didn't say, go into all the world and feed every creature. He didn't say, go into all the world and give water to every creature. He said, preach to every creature. Now, that's not to diminish the need of benevolence. We'll talk about that here in a little bit. But our mission is to see that that lost might have the opportunity to hear the salvation of the gospel, to hear its saving message. But the social gospel then shifts us away from that. We find churches spending millions of dollars on these things pertaining to the physical, while souls languish and die and will go to eternal hell because they have never received the gospel. Can we sleep easy knowing that we fed them, made them comfortable physically, but we've not given them what the Lord has entrusted us to give them? The social gospel also minimizes sin, salvation, and personal responsibility. Jesus said in Matthew 7, 21 and following, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? In thy name have cast out devils or demons, and in thy name done many wonderful works? Some might say in that day, have we not fed many? Have we not given water to many? Have we not built nice schoolhouses for many? And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. As Solomon concluded the end of his life's experiment and saw the purpose of life, he came to realize that the end of the matter, he saw that the conclusion was, fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole of man. This is man's all. This is our reason for existence. That's what gives us meaning, is to fear God and keep his commandments. For God will bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. And so we then have our purpose in life, and we will be judged on that, on whether we have feared God and keep his commandments. 2 Thessalonians 1:8, we're told that on that final day, the Lord shall descend from heaven, and in flaming fire will take vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel. But the social gospel minimizes such things. The social gospel also violates the principle, if any would not work, neither should he eat. 2 Thessalonians 3 and verse 10. And this is the major problem with having such things as soup kitchens and grocery giveaways that never do any type of assessment of need. There is a principle that is to be followed, but the social gospel will typically be found violating that. Other things that could be said with regard to problems with and errors of the social gospel, I invite you to read the manuscript to find out, read a little bit more about that. But let's talk then about the biblical alternative to the social gospel. While error is rightly to be avoided, while it's rightly to be shunned, yet at the same time, some sadly respond to error by running right past Jerusalem to get from Rome. In fairness, we should remember that the formulators of the social gospel were actually running away from errors in the opposite direction. Errors such as ritualism, spiritual lethargy, self-absorption. Those are some of the things that they were getting away from. You know, just looking completely inwardly. Denominations, churches were guilty of doing that. And they said, well, we need to get beyond that. And so, that was one of the motivations for the social gospel. But our intent then, as we say we want not to participate and partake of such error, our intent should not be to get away as far as possible from the social gospel as we can, as some do. They say whatever the social gospel says, we want to be as far away from it as can. What we simply want to do is stand right with the gospel of Christ in every respect. We mentioned that the social gospel was in large part had to do with a misunderstanding of the kingdom, at least as Rauschenbusch formulated his theology, speaking about the kingdom being here on earth and as being presently realized in a sense. And that was one of the factors that led to premillennialism's rise in the 20th century. Not the only factor, there were other things as well, but certainly it wasn't coincidence that it rose at that time. You see, there was a big knee-jerk against everything that the social gospel did among many of the theological conservatives. Moody and others would go in the opposite direction. But yet we don't need to knee-jerk by running to premillennialism. Both of them misunderstand the kingdom. We should understand and appreciate that Christ's kingdom is not of this world. John 18 and verse 36. Appreciate that we can now be in this kingdom and that it is the body of the redeemed that will be delivered up to the Father at the end. We don't need to run to premillennialism. Also, reject the social gospel does not mean that we should reject addressing so-called social issues altogether. That accusation has been hurled against some who preach about such things as abortion, about people who preach against such things as drug abuse, who preach on certain issues that are sometimes deemed social issues. Well, gospel preachers don't preach about such things because they are social issues per se. They preach about those things because they are sin. And we are charged to rebuke sin. And so we address sin where we find it. And if it's in a societal sense, whether it's something we can affect maybe societally, regardless, we preach against things that are sinful. Also, to reject the social gospel does not mean that Christians are altogether to turn their backs on those who are in physical need. It's not our first priority. It's not our mission. But when we come across someone in physical need, are we not to be compassionate as our Lord Jesus Christ was? Jesus Christ came to seek and to save that which was lost. Luke 19:10. We follow that pattern. But as he performed his mission, occasionally came across those who were in physical need, and he addressed them as he was able. Likewise, as we have opportunity, we are to do good unto all men, especially unto them which are of the household of faith. Galatians 6:10. And while the church is not to follow the social gospel's call to radically undermine the social order, that's what they'll often call to do. Such as they would say for slaves back in the day that they would need to throw off their bonds, start a revolution. And we think about how Paul approached the matter in his epistle to Philemon, and how the principles that are found there would indeed get to the heart of every Christian slave owner and would indeed be the leaven that would ultimately bring about the abolition of that godly, ungodly institution. But at the same time, there are ways in which the church will seem maybe revolutionary. The people of Paul's day saw him and others as turning the world upside down. And maybe it will seem like we are turning the world upside down. But our goal is not simply to go about and undermine the social order. Our goal is to preach the gospel to every creature. Again, Steve Jobs made the statement, innovation distinguishes between a leader and a follower. And indeed it does. And some would rather attempt to lead God, attempt to lead Christ and to lead the holy word of God to follow their own capricious wills rather than being content to be followers of God, to be followers of Christ, and to be followers of the holy word of God. Again, what God has given is perfect. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty and continueth then, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed. James 1:25. Friend, it's in that true, perfect law of liberty, the gospel of Jesus Christ, that the most pressing need of man is met. Maybe you've not realized that's your most pressing need. Maybe you've been asking the wrong questions. Some of the questions that maybe were last asked in the last hour, that were mentioned in the last hour, about you might ask, what can you do for me physically? How can you make me happy? But the question is, how can we be brought to God? It's through the gospel. Paul said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God and salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. And so we ask them, are you willing to believe that gospel of Jesus Christ, that good news, that God was made flesh, dwelt among us, died for our sins, and was resurrected? Do you believe that? Are you willing then to repent of your sins as God commands all men everywhere to do, Acts 17:30? Are you willing to confess your lips, that good confession, that confession that leads to salvation, Romans 10:10? That confession that you might make before men that you believe in Christ, that he might confess your name before the Father which is in heaven. Matthew 10:32. And upon that confession, are you willing to submit to baptism, immersion in water, that your sins might be washed away, that your most pressing needs might be met, the salvation of your soul? Friend, the answer is there for you. The perfect way of God is there for you. And if we can assist you, if you need to make amends as an erring child of God through repentance and confession, we urge you to come forward. Or if we can assist you in your obedience to the initial gospel of Christ, come forward as we stand and as we sing the song of invitation.